Hello and welcome to Kaido with me, Andrea D'Souza, your host for this show. Sedition is defined as something that entices people to fight against the monarch or the government of a certain country. It has been in the news a lot these days, and many people are actually filed with sedition in different courts of India. Today, let us talk about this. It's very debated. Some people are for sedition laws, some people are against these laws. And to talk about this, we have with us Advocate Ronak Rao. He's a practicing advocate and he appears in various courts of Goa. He deals in civil, criminal, constitutional and service matters. He's very interested in different socio-political issues and keeps himself up to date with all these various issues. Thank you so much, Ronak, for coming on this show.
Thank you, Andrea, for inviting me.
So, now we are talking about sedition. So, let's begin with what exactly is this?
So, the law of sedition, you will find it in the penal statute of this country, which is the Indian Penal Code. Section 124A is the provision which deals with sedition under the penal code. Of course, usually there's always a parody which is associated with lawyers and laws.
Okay.
So instead of giving you the jargon, to make it simple for your viewers to understand, the law of sedition, to put it very simply, is when a person intentionally either by way of words, which are either spoken or written, by visual representation, or by way of signs, or by any other means, tries to excite hatred, contempt, disaffection, or tries to attempt to excite disaffection towards a government which has been established in this country by law, then such a person can be said to have committed the crime of sedition. Now, of course, the provision is quite, as you have just seen, the provision is quite elaborate. There are so many ingredients which need to be satisfied to bring around a case of sedition against someone. So there are, of course, explanations which the provision carries. Now, there are two explanations to the provision. Both, of course, go to explain the provision that any act of creating any disapproval to try and get your message across with respect to any decision which has been taken by the government or any administrative act which has taken place.
Okay.
And if your actions or your speech or your signs, board, anything that you, any representation that you do, either to an individual or to the community at large, if it does not create an atmosphere of hatred or contempt towards the government, then it will not amount to sedition. That is what, in substance, is the law of sedition, if you look at it threadbare.
Okay, that again can be very subjective, and we'll talk about that later. But as you said, now section 124A of the IPC talks about sedition. So can you talk more about this section? Like, you very well explained what exactly it is. What else about this topic does this section talk about?
Right. Now, I'll give you a little bit of a historical background on how this provision came into being. As you know, the penal statute, the Indian Penal Code, has been brought into the statute book even before the independence. So it's a legislation which is more than 200 years old. So the Indian Penal Code actually was brought in the statute book in the year 1860. As you know, back then there was the colonial disposition of the day, which was the British government as it then was. So the law in the UK is to a certain extent unwritten. It's not codified. But they did take departure from that state of affairs which existed in the UK to a codified law in India, because they wanted that the law should be so specific that a common man should be able to understand as to what is right and what is wrong. Now, very interestingly, when we had the chance to look up or study this provision back in law school, I remember my professor very interestingly telling us a little tale as to how this provision came into the statute book. Apparently, as it goes, it was excluded from the first version of the penal code.
Okay.
And eventually, when it was brought on the statute book, it was because someone questioned, because as you may understand, 1860 was very close to 1857,
which was the
absolutely. So there were a lot of lessons learnt by the disposition of the day from the mutiny, and it was brought on the statute book with the intention to prevent repetition of mutinies, revolts, or seditious speech or acts as they had occurred around the Indian mutiny, the Sepoy mutiny. So that's the historical background with which section 124A actually came into the picture.
And then again, that mutiny.
Yes.
I mean, to them, it was something that was against the law. But to us Indians, it was freedom.
It was our first war of freedom.
Yes.
Technically
so
speaking.
So very
yes.
subjective.
Very subjective.
Very true.
So it's obviously one man's food is another man's poison. That's how it is. So anything said and done, if it doesn't go well or augur well to the disposition of the day, there is a chance that you may be tried or at least accused of sedition.
Very a lot to think about here. So let's take a short break. On the other side of the break, more about this and both the sides of the argument, and let's see what the law actually says about it. See you on the other side of the break.
This is Infomedia Prime Slot Network, and you're watching Prime, your voice, your channel.
Hello and welcome to Kaido with me, Andrea D'Souza, your host for this show. Today we are talking about sedition. What is it? Anything that entices people to revolt against the government, and this is an offense. Many people are for it. Many people believe that this should be scrapped from our legal books. And we have advocate Raunak Rao who's speaking on this. So Raunak, you very beautifully actually explained to us the history of it and where we find it in the IPC. Now, there are some other laws also that talk about sedition. Briefly, which are these laws?
Well, IPC by itself is the criminal code of the penal statute of our country. There are various provisions within the IPC, and there are other special laws which were enacted given the circumstances. Of course, I will first start with the IPC. There are several provisions which deal with such as inciting hatred among communities based on religion, race, language. That's section 505. There are other provisions within the IPC. Of course, I don't want to bother your viewers with provisions, but then more or less offenses against the state or the government, which is established by law, are all in terms of chapter 6 of the IPC. And all provisions such as which are akin or more or less similar to sedition would be provisions of mutiny, provisions of waging war against the state, or disseminating information which is likely to disrupt public order or to disrupt public tranquility or to affect the general law and order situation in the country. There are several such provisions which you will find in the Indian Penal Code. Now, once you step outside the general law, that is the Indian Penal Code, you will encounter provisions such as the Prevention of Terrorist Activities Act, which was the POTA.
Yes.
Then there was the TADA, which was Terrorism and Disruptive Activities Act. And one other provision, which is of course, I don't think most of us would be aware of this provision, which was the 66A of the Information Technology Act, which was very similar to in terms of character to the sedition law. Of course, the Supreme Court of India in Shreya Singhal's case has struck down that provision, so it no longer remains in the statute book. So yes, to answer your question, these are the various provisions which you will find in or about or in the nature of the law of sedition in this country.
Okay. Now, going back to history, it's believed that this law was first invoked against Jogendra Chandra Bose, and he actually voiced his opinion against the Age of Consent Bill of 1891.
Right.
And in 1922, it was also invoked against Mahatma Gandhi himself. So we believe that this is very subjective. So what is the legal view on this?
All right. Now, as we have just discussed earlier on your show, Section 124A came into the statute book after 1860.
Okay.
So historically speaking, prior to the coming into force of the Indian Penal Code, one of the first instances of an Indian being tried under the law of sedition was the case of Bahadur Shah Zafar, which was immediately after the Sepoy Mutiny of 1857.
Okay.
Of course, it was not Section 124A back then, because the law, as we just heard, was uncodified. So if you ask me, one of the first instances of trial on the law of sedition in this country would be the Bahadur Shah Zafar's case, which predates even J.C. Bose's case.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah. So now, to come back to your question, subjectivity, yes, absolutely. Everything and anything about the law is subjective, because there is no straitjacket formula to find out whether a person is guilty of an offense or not. It all turns on evidence. Initially, we had the jury system, which was abolished after the Nanavati case. But prior to that, you had the opportunity of being judged by your peers. So your peers would decide whether you're guilty of an offense or not.
Mm-hmm.
Post the amendment to the abolishment of the jury system, the judge decides, and he evaluates the evidence which is brought on record before him by the public prosecutor. He also hears you if you have to lead any defense.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously, in a given set of circumstances, the judge, if he has to decide whether you're guilty of an offense or not, he will first bring to the fore, what is the law on the subject? What are the ingredients of a provision? Since we are talking on the law of sedition, an essential ingredient, which the Supreme Court has held to be sine qua non, which is like you can't have a conviction on the aspect of sedition without this ingredient being present, and that's public disorder. So unless your speech, your action, your representation, whatever it be, to an individual or to the community at large, if it does not lead or enrage public disorder, then obviously there can't be a trial or a conviction on
under
sedition.
So basically, I can hold a view which is against, for instance, against the government or against something that the government is doing.
Of course.
That's fine. But as long as I don't create some public disturbances, it's okay. Once
Absolutely.
That happens, then y'all can try me against
Absolutely.
This.
That's okay. Your constitutional right, which is guaranteed
because,
to you.
Yeah, and that's my right to think the way I want to, and probably my freedom of speech.
Absolutely.
Okay. Let's take a small break here.
Sure.
On the other side of the break, let's see some landmark judgments under sedition and a lot more. See you on the other side of the break.
This is InfoMedia Prime Slot Network. And you're watching Prime. Your voice, your channel.
Hello and welcome to Kaido with me, Andrea D'Souza, your host for this show. Today we are talking about sedition, and we have with us advocate Ronak Rao. So Ronak, we spoke about what it is and how subjective it can actually be. Now, what are a few landmark judgments that are under this law?
We are a nation which follows the law by way of precedence.
Yes.
So a very good question. Every landmark case sets the course of future for every trial which may come about. One of the most important judgments in my thinking would be to start with Ram Manohar Lohia's case, which was of the year 1962.
Okay.
Now, you would think to yourself that Ram Manohar Lohia being tried for sedition, yes, of course, he has been.
Okay.
And that was one of the first judgments in my thinking, which actually paved way for a more liberal view, because when I say this, that the trend has been, because as lawyers, we study pattern.
Mm-hmm.
We see how the law changes. We, of course, because it's understood that a democracy,
mm-hmm.
in a democratic setup,
mm-hmm.
To have a certain kind of law
mm-hmm.
reflects upon the kind of society it is.
Of course.
And as Indians and as constituents of a vibrant democracy,
mm-hmm.
it's always been a thing with us Indians to have a more liberal view. Over the ages, we have seen that certain laws have been slowly being done away with.
Okay.
Just that way, the same is the case with the law of sedition.
Mm.
Coming back to your question, in 1962, when the Supreme Court had the chance to decide on this issue of Ram Manohar Lohia, his case, in that judgment, a very interesting sort of a theory has been put in place by the Honorable Judge of the Supreme Court, who was then hearing the matter.
Mm.
He said that from a common man's perspective,
mm.
to view the law of sedition, mm. you have to imagine three concentric circles. The center of the circle would be national security.
Mm.
The circle which surrounds national security is public order.
Mm.
And the outermost circle is the law and order.
Mm.
Now, an act which according to the government of the day or according to the prosecuting agencies is seditious,
mm.
if it may affect the public order,
mm.
but it may not affect the national security in a given set of circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
The same act in another set of circumstances may affect the law and order,
mm.
but not affect public order.
True.
So therefore, the law which was set out, and according to me, which paved the way for a more liberal view on the law of sedition in this country, was that judgment,
mm.
which actually went on to liberalize the view, saying that an individual act
mm.
may not affect the public tranquility,
mm.
may affect an individual or a certain segment of people,
yes,
but not the overall tranquility of the society,
mm.
then such an act would not be considered as a seditious act.
That's that, very liberal.
Of course.
True.
Then subsequently in about 1972, there was the other case of Arun Ghosh,
okay.
which was on similar lines,
mm-hmm.
which said that so long as an individual act
mm-hmm.
doesn't disturb the public order
mm-hmm.
and does not disturb the public tranquility, it will not be considered as seditious. One of the more recent cases which we've encountered would be the Binayak Sen's case,
mm-hmm.
where of course Dr. Binayak Sen was a pediatrician.
Mm-hmm.
He was treating a patient who was considered to be a Maoist,
mm-hmm.
and he was suffering incarceration in Jharkhand, and as it so happened that he happened to bring out, at least the accusation against him was such. The case is currently sub judice, so it wouldn't be proper on my part to kind of express any opinion on what the thing is.
Okay.
But the accusation against him is that he would take his writings from his patient and then circulate it in the public domain. And that was considered to be a seditious act, because the law on sedition also says that it's not important that you yourself author any seditious material,
mm-hmm.
even if you circulate
mm-hmm.
knowingly or unknowingly seditious material,
mm-hmm.
which you know to be seditious, then you can be
held.
So which you know to be seditious, if you assume
yes.
that it's not.
Yes, absolutely. If you assume if it's that it's not seditious,
yeah.
then perhaps you may have the benefit of doubt.
Okay.
Well, that is a system of law that functions here. That if there's a benefit of doubt
mm-hmm.
in your favor, then the court certainly rules in your favor and will grant you an acquittal.
Okay.
Now, my final question to you would be, today we see many people fighting for this law to actually be done away with, because, and we see many cases, and I have evidence here which I'm not going to take time reading it, in which they say over 90% of sedition cases are pending trial, and 80% of the time they actually realize that there's no proof to it, you know, but people are still charged with sedition. What do you think about it, and what legal procedure, I mean, what can be done here?
Well, let me say this. There is a very popular sentiment which says that, to start with, firstly, this is a colonial law. We are a vibrant democracy, India. We are a republic. Fundamental rights, the chapter part 3 guarantees to us in terms of Article 19(1)(a) freedom of speech and expression. As a citizen of India, I'm entitled to have my own opinion on certain things. Now, the test is whether my opinion against the disposition of the day, any administrative act which has been taken place, or any political decision which the current disposition of the day takes, in that case, whether my personal opinion is a constructive exercise or not. If I use lawful means today, then there should be no problem for the disposition to encounter any law and order situation. If my opinion is likely to incite hatred, contempt, or otherwise create unrest in the community, then obviously there has to be some amount of responsibility which has to be pinned on me, or at least I have to be held accountable for my actions. Absolutely.
So basically, you express your views, but express it in a way that is very responsible.
Certainly.
Okay. But I would also like to add to this, though, that yes, there are still many cases wherein people are sadly tried under this, in, you know, which is not really, yeah, it doesn't really merit it there.
Of course.
Yes. A topic that we can spend hours talking about, but sadly, yes, we don't have that much of time, probably a part two on this. Thank you so much, Ronak, for coming on our show and explaining to us what exactly sedition is. And our viewers out there, yes, this is in the news a lot these days. This is what it is. So as I say, you have anything that you want us to cover, you have any views, your opinions, your valuable feedback, please WhatsApp us on the number you see below. You can also email us on the email ID you see below. Till then, it's me, Andrea, saying thank you.